welcome to the School of Education colloquium and a special meeting of the Reasoning Group. We're fortunate today to have Paul Thagard, Michael Ranney, and Paul and I go way back, and so far that I have to take notes. But Paul's a great guy and a great friend, and so that's number one, because there are lots of brilliant people, but not all of them are great. But Paul handles both of those. And as you can probably tell from the blurb that went around announcing the talk, he's very august and well-published and all. In fact, skimming over his vita, I think he's got somewhere between 12 and 17 books, certainly like a dozen to 15 with three new coming out that he's an author of, and then three more as editor. And but you think, well, that seems like enough. But no, I was skimming through the CV and looking at various years. And 2014 caught my eye because he had 15 articles and reviews in that one year, 2014, which made me feel terrible. But and that wasn't that hugely an anomalous year. He's been publishing wonderfully for more than one decade, I think it's fair to say. And what's really wonderful about Paul is he does it with a fair amount of aplomb, which also makes me a little envious. He seems to have a really nice way of being able to balance work and life. And in fact, one of the things that struck me is I met Paul when I was a postdoc at Princeton, and he became my mentor, but he was also my softball coach, and so he has many talents. He wrote this one book, I think it was by Ed Mooney, Chris Mooney?
Oh, I forgot about that.
He has nom de plume, a book called Softball Success, and it was, this guy supposedly ran a bowling alley in Trenton, but he was a great coach too. Hopefully he remembers my speed on the base paths. But in terms of his academics, so I recall he was born in Saskatoon, in Saskatchewan, and worked his way through there, out of there, to Cambridge and to University of Toronto, where he got various degrees, including a PhD in philosophy. And was your advisor, Boss von Strassen? So, great lineage there. And meanwhile, he was stooping to conquer while an associate professor. He picked up a master's degree in computer science, mostly AI-ish, if I recall. And that certainly put his work on a new tangent as well. For those of you who know, I teach a class on how to get a job after graduate school, and Paul was such a great mentor that he sort of inspired me, among others like Brian Reiser, to teach the class. And he had great words of wisdom, including one that I tell my students each time I teach it, where when I was had a job at Berkeley, but they were still, the bureaucracy was going so slowly, I had this offer of an interview in a smaller agricultural area. And I was telling Paul, well, this thing isn't a done deal, and you could buy a house for $20,000. And Paul leaned back and said, yeah, and all the dirt you can eat. So, I'm glad I'm here not eating dirt. He's a triple threat. He was in philosophy, also computer science and psychology at Waterloo. And he's working on these this three-volume book right now. Great stuff. And his work on explanatory coherence was what really excited me. I got to work a little with him on the ECHO model and sort of a part of his tech theory, which he has transformed to bring in lots of emotion in various other ways. So explanatory coherence is a big part of me and a big part of the Reasoning Group for those of you who are from that as well. So I think maybe I'll stop there and without further ado, just give you Paul, who's going to be chatting about reason and reasoning, inference and education. So Paul Thagard.
Michael, thank you very much for organizing this. It's great to have a chance to be here at Berkeley. So this talk had its origins because last summer I got invited to speak at two different conferences on reasoning, one in Montreal and the one was Munich. And so I thought, well, maybe it's time to rethink what reasoning is. And when I started working through reasoning, partly from the perspective of my old training in philosophy, but rethinking it from the point of view of cognitive science, the conclusion seemed to me quite startling. So the basic tenor of the talk is going to be that reasoning and inference are often assumed to be the same thing. In fact, that's the way dictionaries do it. But if you look from a cognitive science point of view, you see they're really very different, to the point that it actually raises difficult questions about why is reasoning important at all? Because I think the actual psychological work is mostly being done at the level of inference. Well, I've developed an answer to that, and that's what I'm going to try to do today. So let me give you an outline. So I'll start off by making this distinction, which I think is unusual, between reasoning and inference, indicate how I think they're really very different. And then, in order to provide a theoretical background, I'm going to be describing a new way of thinking about how the mind works, developed by my colleague Chris Elias-Smith. It's a set of ideas you probably haven't heard of about semantic pointers. I actually think this is the best cognitive architecture available today, and it really is what you need if you want to make the right balance between reasoning and inference. And then I'm going to give an argument that maybe we are making a mistake studying reasoning, that it's not doing what we think it is. But then I'm actually going to provide a way from the perspective of the semantic pointer architecture for saying that, yes, reasoning doesn't play the role you think it does in changing the inferences that people have, but it does have a valuable role to play. And part of that depends on a better theory of communication. So I've extended the semantic pointer architecture into a new theory of communication that I think is highly relevant to general questions about teaching and what's involved. For one thing, I think it can help explain why teaching is so hard and much harder than you might think it is. So that's where we're going. Okay, so what's the standard view? That's Aristotle up there. I usually see him in gray busts rather than with but anyway, so this is a view that's been around at least since Aristotle. It's certainly the view that I grew up with as a philosophy graduate student. And reasoning and inference are basically the same. So the reason you study reasoning is you want to help people make correct inferences. And the standard sorts of inferences are deductive ones, inductive ones that introduce uncertainty, practical inferences, which are about what to do, decision making. But reasoning and inference are really operating in the same way. So from this point of view, the sort of thing that back when I taught logic I took for granted is the reason I teach people logic or critical thinking, so they'll reason better, so they'll make better inferences. And from this point of view, it's easy to say what rationality is. Rationality is just using good reasons, following the standards of deductive logic or inductive logic or practical inference, the theory of decision making. So I presume this view is something you've probably all encountered. I certainly took it for granted for a long time. But I think it's actually highly problematic for the reasons that this sort of chart goes. So here I'm comparing reasoning and inference. And the way we're all familiar with reasoning, the way that philosophers think of it, and I think most psychologists used to as well, is it's a matter of language. It looks like we've got deductive arguments. It's serial, step by step. Deductive reasoning, since Euclid has provided the model for that, and modern logic is the same. It's slow. It's deliberate. It's social, because quite often reasoning, you're trying to convince somebody else, so you're using language to try to do that. And it's entirely conscious. But what do we know about inference now from the perspective of cognitive science? It's not like that at all. Because, first of all, it's not just linguistic, it's multimodal. Sure, we use language, but we use lots of other things. We use sensory imagery, we use pictures. I'll talk later on about the Michael Ranney's work on global warming. The big impact of that, which I think is really cool, is using these great diagrams, these sort of animated diagrams, to convey how global warming works. So that's using visual images. You can sometimes use auditory images as well. If you want to convey causality, as that sort of slide does, you want to look at motion as well, because you need the dynamics. So when I'm talking about causality, I don't stand there like this. I'm using body language to indicate how things are changing. So you need motor stuff, and of course emotion. The issues like climate change or issues like vaccinations, which I'll talk about later, are highly emotional issues. And if you don't get emotion into it, then you're simply not going to be able to change people's attitudes very well. And so inference is using all of these things. It's not just using language, the way the standard view of reasoning says. It's also, I think, not serial, it's parallel. It's using the fact that the brain is a parallel processor, your 86 billion neurons are all working together. I've written a bunch of things claiming that what goes on is coherence, where coherence can be understood as a process of parallel constraint satisfaction. It's a matter of balance things a lot. This is inspired by connectionist ideas of how thinking works. And so as far as a lot of the inferences we make, they're fast, they're automatic, they're not under conscious control. It's not something that's social in the way that reasoning is, because you're not giving an argument to somebody else. It's just going on inside your own head. And often what goes on is unconscious. doing. So from this point of view, reasoning and inference are looking really, really different. And so the question I want to raise is, well, if there's a big difference, and this is the actual work that's going on when people change their minds, well, why are we bothering with this stuff at all? Why are we thinking that reasoning is even relevant? And I'll try to give an answer to that. Okay, so most of you, when you see my list, there's a lot of you would have thought of dual process theories, which are really popular now in cognitive psychology and social psychology. Makes a distinction between system one, which things are implicit, automatic, low effort, and nonverbal. Daniel Kahneman didn't invent this, but he's popularized it in his book that lots of people have read, Thinking Fast and Slow. Whereas reasoning is system two. It's explicit, controlled effort, what we do in general. I actually don't find this distinction very useful at all. Why do they call this dual process theories? These aren't theories. What this is actually a loose description of phenomena. It's a sort of classification of phenomena. A theory in cognitive science, I think, is a description of mechanisms. There's no mechanisms here. There's no description of how any of this works. So what we need, if we want to figure out the difference between reasoning and inference, is not deal with this pretty superficial distinction, system one, system two. We've got to figure out what's going on in the mind and the brain that's actually responsible for the fact that sometimes we're in our conscious deliberative mode, and modes of other times we're in the sort of automatic effortless mode. So we need a deeper understanding how this goes. So how are we going to get that? Well, let me tell you about what I think are some of the best new ideas in cognitive science that really show how to do it. Due to my colleague Chris Eliasmith, that's up him, you probably wouldn't have heard about this because the ideas are really pretty new. First publication was only in 2012. Which was Science, not a bad place to start. There's loads and loads of other publications since then. The classic work is his book, How to Build a Brain, from 2013, where he describes what he calls the semantic pointer architecture. I think it's really a major advance in cognitive science because it puts together the two major trends in the field that have been around really almost since the origin. So how did cognitive science get started? It got started in the 1950s when people like Herbert Simon and Marvin Minsky figured that we should be able to build intelligent machines and figure out how people work by using ideas about physical symbol systems. So we'll use ideas that intelligence involves working with symbols, like language, but we can figure out how machines can do that. So that's how AI got started in the mid-50s. And those ideas are still prominent. They're still in cognitive science, things like the ACT cognitive architecture that John Anderson did. Actually, I think they're quite powerful. I don't think they're obsolete, but I think they're incomplete. In the 1980s, a very different way of thinking about how the mind worked developed through connectionists, the parallel distributive processing ideas that came out of originally, I guess, California. So this provided a very different way of thinking how intelligence works. Instead of supposing that you've got symbols operating, generating intelligence, you've got to think of what happens below the level of symbols, because your billions of neurons aren't processing symbols down at that level, but a bunch of neurons working together can add up to the really powerful kinds of thinking that people do. So how's that going to work? Well, that's a different way. And instead of working with symbols, you work with distributed representations, a really key idea in cognitive science, where you think of a representation as not being something like a word or a picture, but rather something that's distributed or shared across hundreds or thousands or millions of very simple processors called neurons. So it's a different idea. Well, how do you put these together? These ideas have been at war with each other now for decades. Well, I think Chris has actually figured out how to put them together. We're at a powerful synthesis that can get the insights of both of them. So how does he do it? Well, he does it by introducing this idea of semantic pointers that I'll explain in a minute, that shows how neural networks can be capable of symbolic processes. Lots of people have wanted to do this, but I think he's really the first one to pull it off and actually show how it works, and I'll provide evidence for that as we go along. Okay, so to understand how this goes, we need to understand two fundamental notions, representation and binding. So you're all familiar with ideas of mental representation, but maybe we need to change at least the familiar part. A representation is just something that stands for something else. And what connections brought in was the idea that no, it's not like single words or pictures. It's rather a process. A
think we should think of representations from this point of view as a pattern of firing in a population of neurons.
Okay.
So that's well known because of neural network work over the last few decades. And of course now it's really popular in AI because of the deep learning work that's taken over a lot of the major companies. Okay, but that kind of neural firing by itself won't get you intelligence, because that's great for pattern recognition, which is the way that companies like Google and Facebook are using it right now, but you can't use that for reasoning. You can't do thinking that way. How do you get more complicated kinds of structures operating? Well, to do that, you have to be able to take your different patterns of firing and bind them into more complicated things. And there are a couple of ways in which people have talked about how binding works. Binding's an old problem in cognitive psychology since the 60s, because every time you have a perception, you need to do binding. So when you see this bottle here, it's not just a jumble of things for you, and you don't just see it as long and white and green. It's all unified into something you see as a whole. You have to be able to bind the features together. Well, how does that work? How do neurons do that? Well, the standard way of saying how they work was to say that, oh, they work, it's a matter of synchrony. So if you've got one pattern of neurons representing one kind of thing, like clear, and another pattern representing long, well, let's just get the long firing and the clear firing synchronized, working together. Okay, so that's one idea. It's actually pretty powerful, but I think there are real limitations to it. Chris has been working with a different idea developed originally by an Australian computer scientist named Tony Plate. He says, no, that's not going to do it, because if you wanted to do binding, you wanted to also be able to do bindings of bindings and collect more complicated kinds of combinations that are crucial for creativity and complex language. To do that, I think the idea of convolution is much more useful, where you can take a neural population and another population and put them together through a mathematical function that's more complicated to explain here, that basically involves kind of weaving or braiding them together into something that then can be used for future purposes. So this works well mathematically, and what Chris did that I think was really powerful is figure out how to get that kind of convolution or braiding to be done by the neurons themselves, to be done by neural populations. So it's a complex function. You take one representation that's a bunch of neurons, another representation is a bunch of representations, a bunch of neurons, and bind it together into a new pattern of firing that can then be bound into other things using convolution. So computationally, this works really, really well. It scales up well also. So that science paper that I mentioned, 2012, was at the time the largest neural network simulation ever done, because they were doing simulations with 2.5 million artificial neurons. So this is very sophisticated. Okay, so now let me tell you what semantic pointers are, because I think this is important for figuring out what's going on in both reasoning and inference. So what are semantic pointers? Well, they're patterns of neural firing. It's just something that neurons do. But Chris figured out how to get them to be really powerful. Why are they called pointers? Well, because they have a sort of pointing function. If you've programmed in C, you know the data structure called pointers. Well, this is the same sort of thing. You're going to have one kind of activity that's pointing to other kinds of activity. What makes them semantic? Well, they're semantic for two reasons. First of all, they're going to have a kind of symbol-to-symbol relationship. So just as in language and in traditional AI, you've got symbols connected up with other symbols, and so you can have meaning operating at that level. So that's one kind of meaning that operates. But the other kind of meaning that needs to operate here is how symbols relate to the world. It can't just be word to word, it's also got to be word to world. And semantic pointers do that because they're intimately tied with perceptual, motor, and emotional information. So some of you I know work on embodiment here, and I think this is going to be an idea of how you can have a neural network structure that can actually accomplish embodying. But it's also going to be able to deal with symbol-like things as well. So it's through this aspect of meaning that you're going to get connections to the world, and this is going to be connections to other symbols. What the simulations show, and there's loads and loads of them now, is it can also support complex syntactic operations. You can do different kinds of inferences. You can do modus ponens, you can do modus tollens, you can do abductive inference because it's powerful enough to enable you to do that. But it also provides a way of controlling the flow of information through a cognitive system in order to accomplish its goals. So what it's doing here is an integration of syntax, semantics, and pragmatics that I think is really important. If you think of what goes on in formal logic, or in computer science, or standard linguistics, is you do syntax first, because that looks easier, and then, oh, we've got to figure out, we got to get semantics in as well, because we've got to get relations between symbols and relations to the world, so semantics is then an add-on, and then maybe if we get around to it, we deal with pragmatics, which is matters of context and matter of purpose. But that's not how the brain works. The power of the brain isn't that it's a syntactic engine or then a semantic engine. It's that it can integrate all of those things together. And I think the semantic pointer architecture shows how to carry out that kind of integration. Okay, so let me give you a picture. So I'm not going to give you all the mathematics of semantic pointers. If you know vector algebra, read Chris's book, and that'll give you a rigorous mathematical basis. But here I'm going to give you a picture. So here's a picture of a semantic pointer. So up there, I've got a semantic pointer. It looks like six circles. You might think that's six neurons. No, think of it as 6,000 neurons or probably 6 million neurons, because it takes a lot of neurons to be able to do this kind of thing. So it's going to be millions of neurons that are formed by binding together other neural representations, where binding is done by this function called convolution. But what we can bind into it is actually very diverse. We can bind sensory information into it, the sort of things we get from our bodies and our sense of where we are in the world. Well, sorry, our what we see through our eyes, our ears, and touch. Motor part, the way we're moving our bodies, that can also be bound into it. This is emotional isn't part of Chris's original theory. I've been extending it in ways that deal with emotion, but I think that's really important, especially for dealing with pragmatic matters, questions of purpose and control. And of course, if you're a human, as opposed to a different kind of animal, you can also get verbal part involved with it as well. So what we want to be able to do is produce semantic pointer as a new kind of representation that's capable of taking these other kinds of representation and binding them together in something that's going to have the full power of both the body and verbal kinds of operations. When you do that, you get something that can actually do quite a lot. It can do inference. As I said, it can do all the standard sorts of inference that logicians, well, maybe not all, but the most important ones that logicians talk about. But it's also a property of semantic pointers, and this is the pointer aspect of it, that they point to where they came from. This is very different from what happens in most current robots. If you look at, say, Google driverless cars, they've got these incredibly powerful sensors, and they translate that all into Bayes nets, which then make really good inferences about what they're going to run to on the road. But they throw away the sensory motor information. What I think is really cool about human thought is we don't have to throw that sensory motor information away. That's why we can still do imagery. We can still imagine things and rotate objects or overlay songs on top of each other. And so in the semantic pointer, it's not that you've translated the sensory motor and verbal stuff. You can get it back. You can unpack it. You can decompress it in the same way that you can decompress a music file, and then so you can play it onto iPad or whatever you want to listen to it through. So we're getting both the ability to hang on to the sensory motor part that can go into it, but also the ability to work with it at the higher level that enables us to do symbolic kind of reasoning. Yes?
Paul said it's okay to ask questions. I thought I'd done it.
Sure.
When you mention inference here, like philosophers are speaking about, that sounds a bit different from the inference versus reasoning that you were referring to otherwise. Like modus tollens as an inference sounds like it is kind of laborious and not sort of like the reasoning versus inferring thing you mentioned earlier. So are you using inferring and inference here in a different sense than you
well,
were?
Well, I'm actually using it broader.
Oh, okay.
It can cover modus ponens and the type of things that logicians do, but it can also cover the kinds of inference that I've written about a lot involving explanatory coherence. So these kinds of networks can do parallel constraint satisfaction really well. They don't do it where the nodes are in my old echo program, where the nodes were sort of symbolic kinds of things. They do it where you've got the constraint satisfaction taking place across the semantic pointers, where then instead of having a node, you've got a pattern of activation. You've got a whole bunch of neurons. So the inference here, I mean both coherence type inferences that are parallel constraint satisfaction and the kinds of logical inferences that are traditional. The important thing is it can do both.
Mm-hmm.
And so you get both worlds. Okay, now, what can this do? Well, Chris has been able to show with his collaborators at Waterloo an amazing number of applications, ranging from natural language processing. A big support to what they're doing is working on robotics. They got an enormous amount of funding right now from DARPA and from the Office of Naval Research for their robotics work. And so there's loads of things that that they've been able to show this approach is powerful for. It's also true that the software that they've developed, this neural engineering system called Nengo, that's now being used in dozens of universities around the world. It's now been adopted, in fact, by the major enterprises that are trying to put neural networks onto chips. So groups of both Stanford and Manchester, which are two of the four most advanced groups, that are at IBM and in Switzerland, but two of the four groups are now running Chris's software on their they're called neuromorphic chips, because you try to make a chip that works there. And so this has got loads of applications there. What I've been excited about it is figuring out ways in which I could apply this to some of the aspects of high-level cognition that I've been interested in for a long time. So we've got publications on emotion. There's actually a new paper under review right now. Intention and action, that was in cognitive science. Theory of consciousness, which I won't talk about today. Theory of creativity. Coolest new paper just appeared in cognitive science last year is a new theory of concepts, where we showed that you can use the semantic pointer theory to unify the different ways in which psychologists have thought about concepts. We can unify both exemplar theories and prototype theories and explanation-based theories of concepts into one kind of neural network. I've been actually spending my life for the last couple of years working on a whole series of applications of this across cognitive science and across social sciences and professions, including education. But this is all going to come out as a package, and so I'm working now on the third book, which applies these ideas to philosophy, because you can actually cover all of philosophy from epistemology to aesthetics in this sort of approach. Anyway, that's why I think it's got this kind of power. All right, but now let's get back to reasoning. Because when I started to think about these two conferences, I thought, well, they're taking reasoning pretty seriously. One was organized by philosophers in Montreal, the other organized by educational psychologists in Munich. Well, why are we concerned about reasoning at all? I mean, maybe if this is what's going on in the mind, we should just sort of kick reasoning to the curb and think we don't really need it. So here's the argument. I mean, why are logicians and rhetoricians interested in reasoning or in logic? Well, the idea that I got trained in is, well, we're going to teach people to reason better, and they're going to think better. They're going to make better inferences. But if thinking isn't working the way it's supposed to, because it's a matter of neural networks operating in parallel, and how does that possibly apply? So I think my most recent book is The Cognitive Science of Science, lots of applications of both explanatory and emotional coherence. And so suddenly the question is, well, gee, where did reasoning go? And there's a kind of cynical view, that I guess they don't think of them as cynics, developed by Mercier and Spanbauer in a BBS paper, that they said, well, this is just misleading about what the purpose of reasoning is. In their paper, got a lot of attention, was that reasoning is just to convince people. That's the function of it. It doesn't matter whether it's true or not. Actually, this sounds a lot like the American government.
That's true.
Confirmation of postmodernism. I never quite thought of that way. Anyway, this is a cynical view. It's, why do you reason? I guess this is a new view. It actually goes back to the Greek, the sophists, Yeah, they didn't care about getting it right. It was just to convince people. That's all that reasoning is for. So from this point of view, reasoning at best is this sort of nasty thing that you might teach in the slimiest parts of the university, as opposed to the search for truth, the way that philosophers took it. And so I think this gives us a reason for thinking, reasons for thinking, well, really, reasoning, why do we actually need that? What's that for? Okay. Well, I think there is a way to reclaim it, but it requires a shift. It requires a shift from the view of logicians that reasoning and inference are the same. You have to realize that they can be connected, but the connections are much more indirect. For example, it says that argument can be valuable, not because you're actually going to convince anybody just with the argument, but what you can do is use it to provide structured information that can help people flip to new cognitive affective structures. See, under the old view, it should be easier, because reasoning and inference are the same, so I give you reasoning, and boom, you get the inference, and then you do it. So, modus ponens, yeah, sure, I got it. Well, I guess I don't know how many philosophy talks I've heard over the years, but really a lot. I've never seen anybody sort of convinced by one. So it's sort of funny that people took that view so seriously. But this suggests what's really going on is, no, all you can really hope for, what you're doing when you're giving an argument, which I guess I'm doing now, is to be able to put together some of the pieces, and so that later, when people move into the other mode, that is inference mode, which is a system one mode, more automatic, then they'll do the sort of adjustment, and maybe thanks to memory consolidation that takes place during sleep, they'll wake up the next day and realize, oh, yeah, oh, maybe Thagard was onto something. So what we get, assuming that inference is largely a kind of coherence process, which is parallel constraint satisfaction, which I'm now thinking of not just constraints among elements that look kind of like symbols, rather they're constraints among semantic pointers, which are already these highly distributed kinds of representations. So maybe what we can do is provide new elements and new constraints and change coherence judgments indirectly. So it's going to be a more roundabout kind of way of doing things. So from that point of view, reasoning can be useful, but it's not useful in the way that people used to think it was. That people go, ah, yeah, now I got it. Premises, conclusion, check, check, check. No, that's not how our minds work. So what are some examples where reasoning actually works? Well, it doesn't work nearly as much as people used to think it did, but sometimes I think there are cases where we are operating more deliberately. In my case, I made an important decision this year to retire from teaching. Didn't have to, but I think I wanted to be able to write full time and got tired of bureaucratic incompetence. So it took a long time, but I did it actually in quite deliberative ways. I even developed a new decision-making strategy you might try, because I didn't want to be impulsive about that. I've heard about people who walk into the chair's office and scribble, I quit, down. No, that's not the way to do it. So what I did actually for almost a year was to have a weekly vote. So I'd have a weekly vote, should I retire or not? And so that was a way of sort of stretching it out over a year and capturing different moods and so on. So that was really quite deliberate. Legal decisions. So what goes on in a juror's head, I'm sure, is quite a matter of inference in the sense that it's parallel, it's emotional, it can be multimodal because you're getting evidence in all sorts of different formats. But on the other hand, the court proceeds in this sort of step-by-step verbal reasoning base. Well, how do you connect the two? It's not because they're the same, but if you do it right, if you've got good presentation of evidence, then you can get verdicts that go into the heads of the jurors, and when they talk it through with themselves, they're able to do the kinds of judgments of coherence, but nevertheless, if you've got a court working properly, at least they're being presented with good arguments. So reason doesn't translate automatically into inference, but it can translate casually into it. And I think it's also, when science works well, it doesn't always work well because there's power moves and bullying in science as well. But when it works well, you'll have legitimate debates about what kind of theory is appropriate, and people will, in fact, have forums like conferences where they get together and debate things or debate them in print, and sometimes reasonable judgments can be made. And there are some real advantages to this, real advantages over to the kinds of automatic system one ways that inference operates, because first of all, you can use writing to overcome attention limitations. One of the big problems with human minds is attention is really limited. There's only a small number of things we can keep in mind at once. Whereas a piece of paper, you write it all down or put your decision in a spreadsheet, then you can at least see it all in front of you. And another big advantage is you can turn decision making from just a completely individual process into something that's social, and you share information with others. So I think this is really the social advantage of reasoning. It's not the cynical one that Mercier and Sperber were pointing about. It's not just to convince other people, it's to have a bunch of people who really do want to make better decisions together. And you can do that by providing information, combining information about both what the hypotheses are and the evidence are and the different kinds of constraints that are operating. So I think from this point of view, reasoning looks different, but nevertheless can still be quite valuable. Okay, but in order to do this, you need a theory of communication. And so a big part of what I've been trying to do with Chris's semantic pointer theory is make it social, because it struck me immediately that it provides a very different way of thinking about how communication works. The standard way of people talk about communication is still as a matter of a message going from one person to another. And so we tend to think of communication based on language, because that's how we talk to each other and we write to each other. And so it looks like it's just a matter of words going from the head of one person into another person's head. But it's way more complicated than that. It's way more difficult. So what are the mechanisms? Well, what do we mean by mechanisms here? That they're systems of connected parts whose interactions produce regular changes. This is how cognitive science works, both in its symbolic form and its in connectionist form. They have different kinds of parts. It could be neuron-like parts or symbol-like parts. But in both cases, you're trying to build a mechanical model of what's going on. That's why computer models are so important, because they enable you to make those things quite precise. And so Chris Eliasmith shows how to, I think, provide the most sophisticated integrated view of this. It's still a mechanistic view, but now you've got new mechanistic parts that are operating, namely these semantic pointers. And so from that point of view, you're constructing and transforming semantic pointers. But now, the way you can think of communication, not as a matter of words from my head to your head, it's got to be way harder than that. Because what I've got to do, if I'm going to communicate to you, is get the semantic pointers from my head that I'm not even consciously aware of into your head, where the semantic pointers are going to involve nonverbal information, they're going to involve emotional evaluations. And so if I'm actually communicating effectively or teaching, I've got to be able to do this kind of communication, not just word to word, but complicated neural practices. Well, how do we do that? Well, we've got to be able to have lots of verbal messages, but also nonverbal messages like pictures, sounds, touches, smells, tastes, movements, and emotions. Values and attitudes go into it. I've got a whole account of values as emotional. And lots of different sorts of ways of doing this, with gesturing, with pictures, with sounds, pointing, tone of voice can be really important, body language, facial expressions. So I think what the semantic pointer theory of communication does is it provides a way of integrating the mainstream work on verbal communication, which, with a fairly small but really interesting work on nonverbal communication, is also being important. A big part of this now is going to be emotional communication, because in debates, even in science, but certainly in any kind of practical sphere around questions like climate change, these are highly emotional issues. And so what you're going to have to convey to people is the facts, obviously, but also a whole lot of values and attitudes. Well, how do you do that? I don't have time to go into it today, but in the Mind Society book, I discuss 12 different ways, or maybe it's up to 14, I forget, ways of emotional communication, ways in which when we're getting a group of students interested in something, or where we're getting an academic audience interested in something, you've got to be, or even talking to your children, you've got to be able to find ways of getting emotions across. And there's lots of ways, ranging from activating mirror neurons, emotional contagion, but empathy can be a really important part of it. Different kinds of interaction rituals, which are really important in religion, where you get people praying together and marching together in the military. So there's lots of different ways of doing that. And so from that perspective, now communication involves all of these different ways of affecting the emotions of other people. It's certainly very important in politics, in fact. And some politicians do really well with nothing but emotional communication. I do a blog for Psychology Today, so if you're looking for a sort of light version of the stuff that I do, you can look at my blog for Psychology Today. And one of the most recent posts is called The Emotional Coherence of Donald Trump, where I give a kind of analysis of why he was appealing to 62 million people. Okay. All right, so now I think you can see how reasoning is being reclaimed. Argument is only a part of semantic pointer communication, but nevertheless, it provides some of the key parts. And so now I'm thinking of reasoning as not that transfer of words and verbal inferences, but rather the installation of semantic pointers. How am I doing for time? Wow. Okay, I have a whole bunch of stuff here about vaccination, but I'm going to skip it. I don't have time to work through that. Okay.
Well, you can go until like 2:15, and we can have 10 minutes of questions.
Oh, but I want, the questions are fun.
Okay. Yeah. What if it works for you? You can always.
So if you want to ask the question, well, what's this got to do with vaccination? I'll help you. Yeah. So, all right, but I'm going to skip over that illustration. So here I think are some lessons for teaching, because I guess this would be useful for school of education. I think there are lessons here for teaching better. The first lesson, obviously, is that reasoning is different from inference. And so if you want reasoning to work, and of course I reason with students, you've got to realize that it's not working the way you thought it did, that if you lay out an argument, people are going to accept it, because inference is this highly parallel, unconscious process. Teaching should be thought of not as taking words from my head and putting them into your head. Rather, it's a matter of taking these far more complicated neural structures, semantic pointers, that involve not just words, but also sensory, motor, and emotional kinds of representations from my head into the heads of the people that I'm teaching. So teaching can have sensory motor aspects, and therefore it can be embodied. I actually think that the semantic pointer, there's lots of work in cognitive science these days that I think is quite important on embodied aspects of education, but also of emotion, also of concepts. Larry Barcel works, probably the best known on that. And I think that's all valuable. But the theoretical basis for it seems to be even kind of weak, because how is it that you're working with these kinds of sensory motor representations? I think the semantic pointer architecture provides a way of understanding how that goes, how these kinds of representations get turned into neural representation, which then can be connected into concepts. But I also think it's a big strength of the semantic pointer architecture that it can be not just embodied. I had to make up a word that meant the opposite of embodied, and the obvious one is disembodied, but I didn't want that because that sounds like ghosts. And I said, I really want to be talking about ghosts. So I made up this word transbody. So the idea here is that when you are teaching in science or mathematics or lots of other areas, philosophy, you're dealing with abstract words like justice and explanation, you need to be able to go beyond the sensory motor part and not just be tied into the body. And so that's what I mean by transbody. You need to be able to go beyond that. So simple mechanisms like a bicycle, you can explain in a perfectly embodied way because you can talk about the pushes and pulls that go into it. But if you want to explain a more complicated mechanism, such as a battery, well, then you've got to be transbodied, because you've got to talk about things like electrons and electrochemical reactions and anodes and cathodes. And so the mechanism for a battery is one that can't just be a matter of embodiment. It also requires the ability to go beyond. And I didn't get into this. This is sort of interesting philosophical argument about theoretical entities. One of the really nice things about the semantic pointers is because they can do not only binding of sensory motor stuff, but bindings of bindings and bindings of bindings, this kind of recursive binding, you can easily become transbody. That is, you can go beyond what we get from the senses. And so that's how you get ideas like electrons, which no one's ever seen or touched or smelled, but nevertheless, you can build up a concept of electron by binding together other things like small and particle that you do get in embodied fashion. So teaching, it has to be embodied, because you do want to get basic ideas like pushes and pulls and quantities into it, but you also have to, if you're going to be even getting up to the level of grade 8 science, where you're talking about electrons, be able to make it transbodied as well. Another part of it that I haven't talked about very much, but I think is really important, is that teaching also has to be emotional and motivational, because if you don't have people's interest, or interest is a cognitive emotion, then they're not paying attention to you. And you got to have some reason for thinking that it's interesting, or better yet, wonderful, or awesome, or inspiring, or exciting, or exhilarating, because that's what provides the emotion, that provides the motivation. And I think because within the semantic pointer architecture, at least the way I've extended it, Chris is a little nervous about this, that cognition and emotion start to work as we know it does in the brain in a thoroughly interactive fashion. We can provide an idea of how this could actually work. Finally, that approach requires a new approach to conceptual change. So that's been a big topic in education for decades. I've written a lot about it in the context of history of science. Well, I've been rethinking the way that conceptual change works as part of the new theory of concepts. because the new theory of concepts, treating them as semantic pointers, actually provides some different ways of thinking about what's involved in conceptual change, including how you get sensory motor aspects of it, including how you get the emotional aspects of it as well. So if you think that conceptual change matters to education, and it surely does, then a better theory of concepts, a better theory that integrates cognition and emotion can suggest how that would work. So I think this is ways to teach better. As a last example, I wanted to just draw on Michael's terrific work on climate change using mechanisms. So I actually used this as an example in Munich last summer of a case where reasoning actually seems to help people because he's got data that show that this will change people's minds. So it's an interesting question. Why, when if reasoning and inference are so different, why is the work done here at Berkeley, which I find really exciting, effective? Well, the best way to look at it is look at their videos. There's this wonderful page where they got videos ranging from 52 seconds up to 5 minutes. And they all show this video. Why is that so cool? Well, I think it exemplifies really well the sort of ideas about semantic pointer inferences that I was talking about. Because this is the static version of the way in which they teach people about how greenhouse gases cause global warming. But the video is even better because you see the animations. That is, first of all, it is sensory motor because it's sensory, because you get to see the different sorts of things. But also in the animation, you get to see the light coming in and bouncing back. And so you get a sense of the causal forces that are operating. Where I think the fundamental basis of causality isn't the way that philosophers have usually talked about it. It's not just universal regularities or probabilities. It's a matter of sensory motor, sensory patterns, the sort of thing that babies are already understanding in a crib. And so this is how it's being captured. So I'm guessing, this is obviously something that I hope would be testable, that what makes this successful is not because they're giving verbal reason, there's doing lots of that as well, but they're doing it in a context where you also get visual representations, it's dynamic, it's causal, and it's body in ways that produce inferences, not just reasoning. So it seems to me, if this seems plausible to you, you're the experts on this, that the approach I've been describing to inference and communication and teaching fits very well with the success of things operating here. Okay, so let me wrap it up. My general conclusions are, first of all, I hope I've convinced you all that reason and inference are really different. In fact, if you want to have inference, we need a different kind of understanding. And I think I've just given you a taste of it, that thought and communication involve this new approach developed by Chris Eliasmith through these really powerful kinds of neural representations that can combine the old symbolic approach that made AI great in the old days and still motivate lots of cognitive science with a lot of the insights that come out of connectionism, where you've got sub-symbolic processes involving distributed representations involving millions of neurons. And what we get out of this is the bottom line from the point of view of education is to realize that we were expecting too much about reasoning. We were expecting that reasoning was actually going to change people's minds directly. It's not going to do that because what's going on in people's minds is very different from the sort of serial linguistic process that's going on in most of the reasoning we do. What we want to do instead is to realize that that's not what its job is. Its job instead is to provide some of the crucial ingredients for the sort of coherence judgments that can actually lead to major revision in people's beliefs and their concepts and their attitudes. And that, I think, is the kind of thing that we should be aiming for in education. Thank you.
Feature of your theory that you might think is a cost of the cinematic kind of reasoning, or you might think is a benefit, depending on your philosophical proclivities. So the feature is that you might think that your account of the function of reasoning collapses the distinction between the function of reasoning proper and sort of arguments by analogy. So here's a famous argument by a French anarchist, he gives this argument where he says that property is theft. Right, is a sort of idea, right? And that's supposed to sort of shift how you think about what property is and make you sort of less inclined towards a sort of capital, or inclined towards a sort of anarchist political philosophy. Now, it looks like what that's trying to do is to instill sort of new semantic pointers in precise something that looks very similar to what you think the function of reasoning is more generally, right? Now, if you're sort of dyed-in-the-wool analytic philosopher, you might think that's a sort of cost of the theory, right? That it collapses the distinction between reasoning, which is this sort of structured thing that goes in serial and lays out the sort of logical steps, and something like argument by analogy, which just gives you this one unstructured sentence, which is that property is theft. On the other hand, you might actually think that that's a good thing. Maybe these things are more sort of similar than one might have assumed in sort of analytic philosophy classroom. So I guess the sort of questions are, one, do you see a functional difference between these two different types of arguments, right? Sort of classical reasoning and the sort of argument by analogy. And two, if there isn't a difference, is that good or bad? Is that a benefit of your theory?
Okay, I'm not quite sure about the second part, but let me address the first part. Sure. I'm really glad you brought up analogy, because that's something I've worked on for a long, long time. And my work has gone through the same kinds of stages here that I described in cognitive science, going from symbolic reasoning in the traditional logic and early AI way to connectionist ones to a different way of thinking now in terms of semantic pointers. So let me see if I can work through your example, which is great. Property is theft. I guess I never thought of that as an argument by analogy. I think he's actually trying to make a conceptual change, but he could say, well, property is a kind of theft. That's sort of an analogy. But what was Proudhon trying to do? He wasn't just trying to change beliefs, he was trying to change attitudes. And so if I did computational models of analogy way back in the early 80s, where I was trying to do it as like verbal reasoning. And then Keith Holyoke and I in the late 80s developed a connectionist model of analogy, treating it as parallel constraint satisfaction. But it was still tied too much to language, quite frankly. We were still treating analogies as linguistic sorts of mappings. So a bit later, I started trying to model things that were more complicated, where you'd have visual aspects of analogies, because some of the analogies we use with are actually working with pictures. The famous one that Dedra Gentner used all the time, the atom is like the solar system. I mean, that's not just words. That's a picture of an atom and a picture of a solar system and mapping between them. And whenever I do that, when it's actually dynamic, I realize talking about the electron moving around the proton and this is like the Earth planets going around the sun. I always do this. It's actually dynamic. It's actually motor as well. So it took me a while to realize that you needed to go beyond the verbal aspects of this. But then in later work, I started to realize what lots of important analogies are actually emotional. And I think that's a big part of what Proudhon is trying to do. He's trying to change attitudes for property from being sacred, as it still is in some political philosophies, to in fact being the opposite. Theft is generally viewed as emotionally. So, and that good analogies also transfer emotions. So you need to have an account that can deal with analogies as sometimes verbal, sometimes sensory motor, and also emotional. And so what I've tried to do in the analogy chapter in the New Brain Mind book is in fact reconceive analogy in these forms. So I actually think analogy is a good case in point where the full range of mental processes that the semantic pointers makes possible are needed to actually capture the kinds of analogies you're talking about. Going back to the second part of your question, what does this do to the traditional concept, understanding of argument? Well, it's really changed it a lot. I mean, there's lots of philosophy work on analogical arguments where they tried to make it sort of like deductive, sort of verbal, never worked very well. I don't think it ever captured the actual cognitive effects of analogy. But now if you see it as having this full range of effects, not just verbal, but also sensory motor and also emotional, the sort of thing that semantic pointers can pull out, it really changes things a lot. And so I think it actually does undercut the traditional understanding and analytic philosophy of inference as applied to analogy as well. Yes.
Hi, my name is Alexander. I'm a fourth year doc student in special ed. And really cool talk. I really like it. I never thought about some of these distinctions. Earlier you were talking about linking, when trying to make meaning, linking like propositions to propositions, this more surface level than this more integrative reasoning where you take different components and make a greater whole, so to speak. So this reminds me of like Kinch's situation model and David Pearson's script implied text implied inferencing. My question is, when you conceptualize these differences in integration, do you see these as like two separate cognitive skill sets, like to link propositions and to have that surface level kind of coherence binding, or and then integrating more aspects to make sort of a situation model as a different skill set, or these one ordinal kind of continuum?
Well, it's not ordinal. You think of it more in terms of parallel processing. The brain's doing all of these things all at once. And the real power of the brain comes from being able to integrate all these different sorts of things by means of parallel processing. So that means that they've got to be going on, but they've got to be tied together if you're going to have a powerful mind.
Would you say it's the same skill set that does the linking of the propositions, that does all the other kind of motor and perceptual and background knowledge and world knowledge and everything kind of put together to make meaning?
Well, I think there are individual differences. Different people can handle different aspects of it. I'm not very good at spatial relations, for example. And so I know people who are just way better than I am at being able to manipulate visual kinds of representations. So there's individual differences there, but I can do it to some extent. And for a lot of things that I do, such as finding my way around Berkeley today, it's really great when you're able to work with the sensory representations and with the verbal representations and bring the power together.
Okay.
I'm just wondering what you think the aha moment is, because it feels like it's almost a discrete level thing, like you're like a reasoning task, like you fill in this link and you say, oh, I get it. But if understanding is really this sort of inference layer, is the aha moment just reaching a certain threshold of links, or is it an illusion?
Okay, that's in the 2011 paper on creativity. So basically, here's roughly how it works. So what's creativity? Creativity in general, this is an old idea that goes back at least to the 18th century. Creativity isn't anything mystical. It's just a matter of taking representations that were previously unconnected and putting them together for the first time. But how does that work? And that's a really interesting question. So you could think of it as one word and another word and putting it together, but well, how do you do that with words? Here, the take look quite different because we're thinking not in terms of words, but these different multimodal representations of semantic pointers. And so creativity is going to become for taking one semantic pointer, another semantic pointer, and then binding them together in a new way. But that's not aha yet. This sort of thing could be going on unconsciously all the time. It's happening in language processing, it's happening in perceptual processing. So that's not going to get to the aha moment. What you need to do to get to the aha part, as we talked about in the 2011 paper, is that you get a combination that also requires an evaluation, because it's got to get emotions involved. So the aha emotion is emotional. It's excitement. It's wow. There's one researcher who even compared it to orgasm, which I think is rather an exaggeration. But it can have an emotional side to it as well. I mean, it's always going to have the emotion. But it's another dimension, but that's where the semantic pointer theory of emotions, which come along more lately, comes in. So I don't have time to tell you the whole theory of emotions. But anyway, you need that. How do you get to consciousness? Well, the claim of that for understanding consciousness, you need the two mechanisms that I talked about before. You need to have the formation of sensory, motor, verbal, emotional stuff into semantic pointers, and then you need to have binding into more things. But there's another mechanism you need, which is competition. And so you've got competition going on among semantic pointers all the time. Sometimes it's a matter of parallel constraint satisfaction. Sometimes this is a matter of battling out for attention, because attention is very limited. And so your semantic pointers are competing for that very limited kinds of attention you've got there. And if you manage to take one semantic pointer, another semantic pointer, bind them together, and it's so new and satisfying to your goals that it gets a whopping big emotion attached to it, that's going to enable it to break through into consciousness. And that's where you get the aha. Yeah. So aha is emotional semantic pointer competition.
Okay.
no one else is going to do it. How does this all relate to vaccines?
Dear.
We don't have to, you can do a summary?
I'll give you the 1 minute summary rather than the 6 slides because I would think of all the remaining time.
Yeah.
The vaccine controversies are really interesting because obviously it is an education problem because you've got lots of people who aren't vaccinating their children. And I think that's scientifically ludicrous. There's almost no evidence that's worth anything that vaccines are supposed to be dangerous the way they're supposed to, that causing autism or things like that. So it's a massive problem in public health. What you need to do is educate people. How do you do that? People tried using traditional reason. They tried to say, well, look at the statistics and you see that there are flaws in the studies. And one 2012 paper found really depressingly that people who had gotten these reasoned arguments were less likely to vaccinate their children because it became really quite salient. Oh, I never thought that it might be dangerous before. So that really is a failure of reason. But there is one study done at UCLA by Keith Holyoke and some of his students that I see is really a nice analog to what you've done at Berkeley with the climate change stuff. Well, except you're actually still pretty cognitive. You don't get into the emotional stuff much. But what they did at UCLA was published in 2014, I think, was to play up the emotions. They asked the way they could get people to think maybe I should get my kid vaccinated was to show them horrible pictures of children with measles. I mean, this was almost rhetoric, but it was visual, it was emotionally impactful, and you're tapping into what are the good motivations that parents have. That is, they're not bad parents who don't want to vaccinate their children. They're ignorant, they care about their parents, but their children. And so when you show them this poor kid disfigured from measles, that's going to kind of scare them into doing the right thing. And so that's, I think, support for thinking that what you want, if you want to educate people about vaccination, is do it in a way that taps into all of these things, not just the statistical facts, not just the causal mechanisms involved with vaccines and how they work, but also the emotional aspects of it as well, and in this case, the visual representation of measles, not just as a disease. So that's the basic message about vaccines. Yeah.
I thought Lee might actually ask the question I'm about to. Because she was involved in writing up some of our results so far, is that when you were showing a picture of the global warming mechanism visually, there was almost like an implicit hypothesis that the visuals, you know, add a fair amount to like the narrative and so forth. And we actually ran an experiment which had like 21 conditions, but the main 9-1 was to compare our 5 videos with 3 different amounts of text, just purely text.
Wow.
And because we wanted like a consumer reports thing, like, well, which of these is better? And it turns out that immediately after, and Lee can correct me on this if I get it wrong, but the longest video and the longest set of words were kind of similar in how much it reduced people's denial of global warming. That's the 5-minute video and then just the transcript of the 5-minute video. And the video was just a little bit more efficient than just the words. But then 9 days later, when we tested people, the words actually, it was a little bit more effective than the videos. Mm. And I was wondering if some of it might relate to consolidation, where, you know, like at night when their hippocampus is talking to their cortex and all, and it's consolidating, they're allowing the images that they generated on their own to generate perhaps richness. And I'm sure there's a lot of individual differences. Some people are doing that and other people are doing different things. But it seemed like at first the mechanism we forced on people with our own visuals seemed a little bit potent, but then 9 days later, kind of like how people, when they read a novel, they are kind of disappointed when they see the movie because like, well, that didn't match my Gandalf, you know, that kind of thing.
Well, that's a really interesting question, how much when people are getting the verbal description, they're doing what people often do when they're reading novels is, in fact, generating the visual mental model. I don't know how you'd control it. I mean, there are some natural controls because some people are much better at visual reasoning than others.
Also, people can go back and reread something, and they're not as likely to go back and review something, so there are other processing aspects too.
Yeah. So anyway, my explanation here was just conjectural, but I think it's great to do those kinds of studies to try to see whether the dynamic, causal, sensory, motor aspect of it really is important or not. Yes.
Great.
I guess my question is somewhat related to that. I'm wondering about the individual differences class question as it relates to classroom teaching. So if there are people who don't see, or people who maybe have already bound some concepts in very different ways, how do you deal with those differences in trying to elaborate new processes of reasoning? That's the first part of the question. And the second is, if you wanted to teach something like perspective taking or working in teams or dealing with people who have very different bindings for similar ideas emotionally or whatever, how might that be done given this theory?
Well, I think you know as much about that as I do. I don't really know. The general advice I'm suggesting is, well, be multimodal. Mm-hmm. And just use words as effectively as you can, but use everything else that can, including sensory motor part. This account of causality, I think I first developed in my book, The Cognitive Science of Science, and I was really inspired by developmental work, where I think it was René Baillargeon found that within, by the time infants are just a few months old, they can tell the difference between that sort of thing, well, that's boring, that happens all the time, and that. It's all Michaud types of causality work. But infants are, so I think there's already a kind of entirely non-verbal understanding of causality there. So what you want to do is adopt all the different ways you can, from pictures and acting things out, combining with the words, and as well as worrying seriously about changes in emotional attitudes. So you put together into an educational package something that operates like the semantic pointers do, where all these things can be interconnected. So that's my general advice. How it plays out in these specific cases, I really don't know. That's going to take experimental work.
Yes. So I have a question, maybe it's a paradigm question about evidence, falsifiability, and so on. So many of us here are involved in empirical work, doing experimental instructional interventions, working with children, learning things like about atoms and so on, or mathematical concepts. And these are rich data we have of children interacting with each other, with an instructor, and so on. And my question is, maybe it's a non-question, I'm not quite sure. Having listened and reasoned about this talk, what would count as in our empirical data as evidence one way or the other for this kind of perspective? Or another way of asking is, equipped now with these ideas, what can I maybe see in my empirical data that I would not see otherwise? Or how could I maybe use my empirical data or any empirical data to evaluate these arguments?
Yeah, it's a wonderful question. I mean, some of it I'm sure you already do, which is you're looking at particular concepts in, say, mathematics that do seem to depend very much on the embodied kinds of understanding, the sensory motor aspects, and so see how that pops up. But you also want to be able to step back and figure out, well, what's actually going on in the mind and what happens. I think that experiment is obviously crucial to cognitive science, but you need theories to explain things. What's going to enable you to do that? So it's going to depend on a particular kind of domain we want to see. So what would operate with sort of in your area in math education? See, I'm way better at theory than an experiment. So asking me, well, generate an experiment to test this. Well, sorry, that's not exactly my department. So I've collaborated.
That's going to be a paradigm.
Yeah, I've collaborated with loads of psychologists, but they do the experimental heavy lifting. And I just build computer models and develop theories. So I'm not very good at that. But it's a perfectly fair question, because I'm happy at this point to be able to say, here are these phenomena. There aren't good explanations of it. I'm going to offer a mechanistic understanding that could account for it. And so it's not at the level where you can give precise predictions, but you can try to make sense of the things that people are doing. A good example of that, where I'm more at home than, say, math education, which I don't know anything about, is emotions. So the big paper on emotion we just submitted involves simulations of a bunch of different well-known experimental experimentally identified aspects of people's emotional reactions that I don't think any current theory can explain, but we can actually develop a precise model and use it to simulate these five different sets of experimental phenomena. So the job in the case of education would be something like, well, here are a bunch of phenomena that are really important, that are both, I think, embodied and disembodied. No, sorry, transbodied is the word I made up. And then none of the current theories can explain that. I'll give you an example of what seems to me a real failure in that. 2 years ago at the Cognitive Science meeting in Pasadena, I heard Jay McClellan from Stanford talk about his big plan to use PDP models, parallel distributed processing, to explain high school education in mathematics. He said that we're going to do it. Mm-hmm. He said it in front of 800 people. And I thought, I know PDP models well. I said, you can't do that. You can't do that because you don't have the ability to do the complex of high-level bindings that are needed to get sophisticated mathematical concepts. So I don't know much about math education, but I know quite a lot about the history of mathematics. And of course, some of the concepts are highly embodied, basic ideas about number and quantity. But math develops in very sophisticated ways. You get group theory, number theory, trends, finite set theory. You get away from sensory motor stuff really pretty fast, even by the time you're doing high school geometry and getting into pre-calculus. So I didn't think PDP style connectionist models could do it. The symbolic models that come from traditional AI, well, of course, you could build rules that have the concepts built into that, but that's not very good. They're not very good at learning. Not very good at figuring out how people go on. I didn't think that would do it. I think it would be a wonderful project to try to figure out whether the full range of education in mathematics, going from preschoolers up to what happens in high school, could be put together in enough detail that you could build this kind of model of it. That's a long project, but that's the kind of test. And sometimes things don't work. Cognitive science sometimes works by not just experimental failures, but also by modeling failures. And I think it would be very interesting to find out. I think this would go all the way up, but the way you could test that is by having a really good array of experimental phenomena that you seem to be targeting, and then develop the models that would actually do that. But that's, you know, that's a really nice 10-year project. But that's the test. It's not a simple Popperian test, which is, if this theory is right, then we'll get exactly this experimental result. It's going to be, there are already lots of experimental results in education in the way that there are in emotions, but not a good enough theory to put it all together. If you can figure out how your theory can simulate all of those things, then you've got some reason to think you're on the right track. So that's what I think should happen.
If I read a narrative and some kid in the narrative gives his toy to a little kid, and I ask, why did the kid give his toy away? And I give an answer. Is that not an inference? Like, because it's, my response is a reason, not an inference, but I retrieved the inference to give the reason? Is that how it would be, you would explain that?
Yeah, that's an inference. But the inference may be more complicated than you're consciously aware of. So when you turn it into words, then it turns into a reason. It becomes reasoning. You could say, he did that with the toy, or she did that because, and you give it. But in your putting it together, you could be using lots of different processes. I've done a little bit of work, for example, on visual explanation. And suppose you go out to your car, and there's a big gash along the side of it. Well, that's a kind of inference that philosophers call abduction. It's generating explanations. But you don't have to do that just in words. You could do it in words. You could be, oh, let's see, if somebody took a key and scratched it along, then that's where the scratch came from. But also could be something visual, because running a kind of movie in your head, or a kind of a motor movie in your head, thinking someone took their key and scratched it along. So it could be that at the level of inference, it's in fact something that's visual motor. And then it becomes verbal reasoning when you convey it to somebody else. So that's how reasoning is going on in this kind of system one way, but then you translate it into the verbal way as the next step. The problem with the history of logic is it took the surface as being evidence for what goes on underneath, but cognitive science, I think, very valuable use has overturned that.
One of the things we've looked at in terms of emotion and in our work is surprise. That is, like, we find that if you ask people to generate an estimate and then they get feedback on something, they're more likely to change their view or their policy than if you just show them the number. That is, that surprise yields this cascade of inferences. We call it numerically driven inferencing. But one of the things we also, that struck me more interesting about climate change is fear. You know, that just in talking with a lot of people, it strikes me that people sometimes deny climate change because they're afraid for their older self or their kids or their grandkids or what it means for their big SUV, something like that. And I'm wondering if you, in your work on emotion, you've seen like some emotions that bubble to the surface as having the most motive force, because, you know, like, different people have analyzed emotions and they're like, some have two dimensions of emotions, some three and more. So you have a sense of like where there's some like real primary emotions that cause the most change in people's minds?
I don't think there's data in that. Certainly our theory doesn't have it. The way our theory of emotion works is, you're not going to be surprised at this point to realize it's a semantic pointer theory. Mm-hmm. So what we've got is we can handle the embodied aspect of emotions, the matter of physiological change, but that gets iterated at the brain level with the kinds of assessments we do about their significance. So we managed to combine cognitive and physiological theories of emotion, which have been battling it out for 100 years, into a common brain theory because they get integrated into semantic pointers. So the things you mentioned, fear obviously is an emotion, but surprise is an emotion too. What happens, I think, goes on with surprise, it's where we've got a set of expectations that are built up and then they're violated. And so we've got a coherent way of seeing how things are going to happen, and then something comes in that's incoherent with that. And that's that where a surprise, tied in, of course, also with the physiological reaction we've got. But I think it's a really interesting question. I don't know what's the data at all. Which emotions are most likely to bring about change? Sometimes fear can go both ways. It can lead to change, but of course, it can also lead to conservatism and people refusing to change at all. But I think that's just a really great area for investigation.
And in Keith's cool work on vaccinations, fear was something that did the trick for them, the pictures of the measles kids and all, right?
Yeah, but it doesn't always work that way. Sometimes when things are scary, it makes people just want to ignore them, make them go away, stop looking. I don't want to think about how awful the world would be if global warming is really true, because that means I shouldn't be flying out to California, and it means that 50 years from now, the world's going to be a really horrible place. So I don't want to think about that. So fear works both ways. It's not clear what would be the sort of optimal way of using that to encourage education rather than stopping it. Surprise, probably the same thing. Sometimes surprises are pleasant, and that's interesting. You certainly want to get cognitive educational emotions like curiosity and wonder and awe operating, but there's loads of other ones that you want to keep out of the picture, like embarrassment or guilt or resentment. These are the sorts of things that tend to lead people to stop learning and want them to become willfully ignorant. So it's really complicated how to get those in. But the general lesson that I think comes from all the research that's been done in recent years about how brains operate, not with a cognitive system and an emotion system, but complete integration of them, and with this sort of lesson here from semantic pointers, is you want emotion to be part of your educational strategy, because without motivation, you don't get learning. Yes?
Is there anything like semantic unpointing, what we have an association that creates a misconception, we want to disassociate those things? Is there a process of unpointing?
We've never used that term. In the philosophy book I'm writing right now, I talk about four different kinds of explanation, using narratives, using deductions, using mechanisms, my favorite way. But also there's another one using elimination. Because sometimes the best way to explain something is to explain it away. So if someone says to me, can you explain immortality? I say, well, sorry, it doesn't exist. So that's a kind of, maybe that's what you mean by unpointing, is you realize, no, there's nothing to be explained there.
But at like an architectural level, are they actually things disassociating from each other?
Well, at the architectural level, that's something that semantic pointers can do, not by completely taking them apart, but through the unpacking or decompressing process that I talked about, the way in which when you bind, say, sensory, motor, verbal things into the semantic pointer, you can get approximations of the different parts back. So I guess that's sort of the unpointing aspect of it, what Chris calls decompression or unpacking. That is actually, I think, really important for lots of kind of learning, for all the kinds of inferences that people make using visual and auditory imagery, or taste imagery as well. There's a AI program produced by IBM called Chef Watson, and it's actually kind of impressive. It's got, it uses AI techniques to generate new recipes, and they're quite reasonable and quite creative, but it's not like a human. So the way I occasionally come up with new recipes, much to the regret of people that I'm cooking for, the way I come up with new recipes is I imagine if I take that and that, what would it taste like? Chef Watson doesn't do it that way. It's got this big database of things, and it actually knows way more about the biochemistry of taste than I do. So it uses all the stuff. I kind of imagine, how would those things taste together? So I'm doing a kind of binding there of different tastes in order to create something new. But then I can take it apart. So if I taste something in a restaurant, I go, that's interesting. What did they put in there? Oh, there's a little basil there, and maybe a bit of oregano. And so I can decompress it or unpack it, and maybe that's what you mean by unpointing. Yeah, so I think a big part of the power of human minds over any AI system that currently exists is that we can use our embodied learning of these different representations, putting them together, but also taking them apart in the way that we operate with imagery, which current AI systems don't, even though we're getting really good at things like pattern recognition. Yeah, so in that case, unpointing is a good idea.
Well, we've hit the 2:30 mark, and I'm sure Paul wouldn't mind folks come up with a question or so afterwards that he got that he's off to copy. So I really want to thank Paul and for his attention, and thanks for giving us so much to reason and maybe infer about. Thank you. Thank you.